I'm going back to the Sea of Galilee about 2,000 years ago. So I'm going to have you close your eyes for just a second. Listen to the sound of the waves lapping against your boat. Feel the wind and sand blowing on your face. Feel the heat of the sun burning down on you and the water on your hands as you cast the net over the side of the boat, for you are a fisherman. Suddenly you hear a voice from the shore calling, "Leave your nets, follow me." You turn to the source of the voice and see Jesus of Nazareth. Okay, open your eyes. What do you do? We'll come back to that question later. First, let's look at what the disciples did. Simon and Andrew immediately left their boat and followed Jesus. Peter and James and John immediately left the hired hands and their father Zebedee, mending the nets on the boat, and followed Jesus. I often wonder if I had been on a fishing boat offshore and heard Jesus calling, would I have left my home, my family, my job to follow him, not knowing where it was going to lead me? But yet, Jesus does ask us to leave our nets behind. They're not the woven nets that the fishermen throw over the side of the boat to catch the fish. They're the nets that keep us from putting God first in our lives. We have nets from the past, things that we haven't let go of, people that we haven't forgiven, that are holding us back from putting God first. Nets from the present, and each of us only knows what those nets in the present are that are holding us from putting God first in our lives. They could be wealth, ambition, family, numerous other things. But we have to put God first in our lives and let go of those nets. Nets from the future. Fear. Fear is a net from the future that often holds us back from doing what God wants us to do. Many people feel that only pastors and missionaries receive a call from God. Is that true, Henry?
Yeah.
No. God has a calling for each and every one of us. The people that God calls, the people that God uses and chooses are plain, ordinary, everyday people. They are you and they're me. If we look at a few of the people in the Bible, Craig told us a little bit about them this morning, we see plain, ordinary people being asked to follow God and perform pretty much extraordinary tasks. Look at Moses. Moses was seeing that bush. It was on fire, but it wasn't burning. So he kind of suspected something was going on there, that that might really be God's voice calling him. But how did he respond to God's voice? What did Craig say? How did Moses respond? Yeah, I'm gonna go lead the people out of Egypt. No, Moses didn't do that. Moses argued with God. You got Moses on this side saying, who am I that you're gonna send me, God? Why send me? And God on this side is saying, I'll go with you. It's all right, I'll go with you. And then you've got Moses saying, who shall I say sent me? I don't know your name. You're God, but you've never told me who you are. And I'm going to go to Egypt, and I'm going to say, he says, let you go. And they'll say, who? So God says, I am that I am. So then Moses comes up with another one. They won't believe me. They're not going to believe that you sent me. No. You know, if I go to Egypt, you know, and I say, I am that I am sent me, they're not going to believe me. So God gave him a few signs. God told him to take the staff that was in his hand and throw it down. When he threw the staff down, what did he become?
Snake.
A snake or a serpent. And then God told him to pick the serpent up by the tail, and Moses was looking at him like, I really don't want to do that either. But he picked the serpent up by the tail, and it turned back into his staff. Then God gave him another sign. He said, take your hand and put it under your cloak. So Moses put his hand under his cloak. He said, pull it out. When he pulled out his hand, it was covered with leprosy, which was a disease in those times where your skin was like falling apart, and it wasn't a very good disease. So God told Moses to put his hand back in his cloak again, and when he put it back in and pulled it out, it was clean. It was clear. And God said, I'll give you other signs. The Egyptians don't believe those signs. But believe me, I'll give you signs. They'll know you sent me. So Moses' next problem was, I am not eloquent. I'm slow of thought and speech, so I'm not really the right one for this job. And God said, I will put the words in your mouth. I will help you through this. So God, or Moses pulls out his last stop here. He says, can't you just send somebody else? And at this point, God is starting to get a little angry with Moses, but he says, I will send your brother Aaron with you. Aaron is an eloquent speaker, and Aaron will be your speaker. He will speak for you. So Moses didn't really want to go back to Egypt. He was a murderer. He left Egypt on very bad terms, and people in Egypt were still out to kill him. But he realized that he wasn't going to get away with this. He finally had to go. So far from desiring to go to Egypt, he went, and he answered God's call. Now we have another person in the Bible, Jonah. Jonah responded in a different way. Jonah was a prophet. God called Jonah to go to Nineveh because the Nineveh people needed to repent or they were going to be destroyed. Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh, so he decided to hide from God. Instead of arguing back, he got on the boat and he was going to go hide from God. Well, how did that end up for him? He ended up in the belly of a big fish. And while he was in the belly of the big fish, he had a little conversation with God. And he decided that he was going to go to Nineveh. And when he was spit out of that fish, right, Henry? Jonah got spit out of the fish. When he was spit out of the fish, he went to Nineveh. And he preached to the people there. And they repented. So God uses plain, ordinary people. What does God's call mean for us today? For most of us, answering God's call does not mean leaving our homes and our families and our jobs. It means putting God first in our life. God's ways are above our ways. His thoughts are above our thoughts. God knows better than we do where we need to be, and he calls us to be there. His calls often confound or confuse us. We may get a call and we're like, I'm not ready for that one. But God chooses the time. We don't choose the time. He may call us in a direction where we don't feel comfortable going. We'll say, just like Moses did, that's not for me, it's on somebody else. But he calls us in directions where he feels that we need to be. Many of us, I think most of us here, have been Christians since childhood. And we've never had that kind of call that Paul had on the road to Damascus, where he was literally blindsided by God and called to follow God. But yet, all of us have had calls all through our lives to follow Jesus and to do things in his name. Sometimes these calls come when someone asks you to do something. Like someone may say, we need a treasurer, or we need somebody on this board, or we need someone to go visit someone. So sometimes the calls come by someone asking us to do that. Sometimes the calls come as a gentle nagging that just won't go away. You feel like, I should be doing that. Okay, forget about it. I should be doing that. Until finally you realize that God really wants you to do it and you answer the call. Sometimes that call comes as one of those big aha moments, like, whoa, this is something that God's calling me to do and I need to be doing it. But no matter how that calling comes, God challenges us to accept that calling. And when we do accept that calling, we find that we are changed. We're not alone. God is right there beside us. He's leading us, guiding us, showing us the way, helping us to do what he is asking us to do. When we accept that challenge, we are able to do things in his name that we never thought that we could do on our own, and we probably couldn't do on our own. No matter what the calling, whether it's just a simple calling to serve on a committee or whether it's a major life-changing experience, we are changed when we accept that call, just like the disciples were changed when they left their boats and followed Jesus. During my lifetime in the church, I've been called in a lot of responsibilities. I've taught Sunday school, ran vacation Bible school programs, been on a program that visited the elderly, part of the music ministry, playing the piano, singing in choir, singing for the elderly and disabled when we do our Christmas caroling, serving on committees, leading the youth group, taking part in the Christian outreach program, which after Kristen was involved in it first, and then Craig was involved in it, and then John and other people got involved in the Christian outreach program from this church. And currently, I sort of had that nagging for a long time that someday I might want to become a lay servant, and that might be something God was calling me to do. But I sort of ignored it while I was working because I can't make the trainings and I can't do that. But this time when I saw the email, and I was like, whoa, those are 2 days I can actually do that. So I'm being called to serve as a lay servant. But I want to share with you this morning one of the callings I received and how I responded more like Moses than the disciples. This was the calling when I first got involved with Christian Outreach. My daughter Kristen had gone to Christian Outreach with the Newton Youth Group, because we didn't really have an active youth group going on in Harmony Hill at the time, and we weren't even aware of the Christian Outreach program. Now, Kristen came back from that program, and she has such infectious enthusiasm and was so excited by the program, because it is a life-changing program, that we had four youth the next year that wanted to go to the program. Now, the program is, you have four youth that work with one CRE leader under the supervision of a supervisor to do repairs on houses of the elderly, disabled, or low-income individuals. And the thing about the program is if you send four youth, you have to send an adult. So we had four youth that really, really wanted to go to Christian Outreach. But my response was, I'm a social worker. I don't know anything about fixing houses. This is not for me. I don't know how to do a roof. I don't know how to paint a house. I don't know how to do any of this. Send somebody else. But then, on the other hand, I had four youth that I knew could possibly be going to a life-changing experience. And was I going to let my fear of the future hold them back from experiencing this experience? So I decided to step up and answer the call. And I went to Christian Outreach that year. And the first thing that I discovered as soon as I got to Christian Outreach is that I wasn't alone. God was there with me. He was guiding me and helping me. And it was a Christian Outreach family. And I mean a family. The youth, the homeowners, the adults there, it was a family. The groups got together to finish their projects as a team. The youth were leading the worships. The youth were doing the sermons. They were doing the prayers. It was just an amazing, life-changing experience. Our homeowners were changed, too. Our homeowner that first year, she was a little woman, but she was sort of on the old side. I won't say she's elderly, because, you know, I have trouble figuring out how old people are. But she didn't have many of the comforts of home. She didn't even have a working bathroom in her home. So I don't know how this happened to my crew, but four times in the times I went to Christian Outreach, there were no working bathrooms in the home, and we had to find someplace else to go to the bathroom. You know, once it was at a school, once it was down the hill, whatever. But what she wanted was she wanted her house painted, because she thought that when people were driving by her house, it was on like a major road. She didn't want people looking at that house and looking down on her because her house was in disrepair. And she was out there with us, with her little foam paintbrush. She was painting the trim on the house. She became a part of the Christian Outreach family. And my crew and I learned something from her that year. We learned how much something little means for someone who has not much. It was her birthday that week. We bought her a box of cookies. And we thought, you know, at lunchtime, she's going to come out and celebrate and have the cookies with us. She didn't have much. She took those cookies in the house and we never saw them again. So we learned how much a simple box of cookies meant to someone who didn't have much. I thank God for that call to go to Christian Outreach that year. Even though I bought it, I thank him for that because my life was changed. I ended up going back to Christian Outreach 14 more times. My children all went to Christian Outreach. Many of the other people in the church experienced Christian Outreach. Craig went. I know that Brett went to Craig Adam go to. And Fran and Martha and Warren went. Issa went. Jeff Guther went. We had a lot of young people get involved in that life-changing experience, all because Kristen went to Duke and then came back and wanted more people to go the next year. So I thank God for that. I'm sure each of you has experienced calls in your life and have responded to God. But the thing is, God continues to call and challenge each of us individually and as a congregation. We are going to be experiencing more changes at Harmony Hill, the transition. We're happy for Pastor Todd that he's getting ordained and he's moving on to his full-time ministry. We're happy for Pastor Nancy that she's accepted the call to come to Harmony Hill. But the changes aren't going to just be for Nancy and Todd. The changes are going to be for us. And many of us will be hearing God calling us in one way or another, whether it's that gentle nagging or whether it's a ha moment or whatever. We're going to hear God calling us in new ways as our congregation changes. I'd like to take us back to Galilee for a minute. You don't have to close your eyes, but you have just heard Jesus of Nazareth off the shore saying, "Leave your nets and follow me." How do you respond? Can we pray? Lord, thank you for the challenges you are calling us to. Remembering the response of the apostles, to be like them, and in the words of the hymn we just sung, let us like them without a word rise up and follow thee. Amen.